Dignitaries and my lovely audience present over here. It gives me an immense pleasure to welcome you all in the second edition of Virtual Aurum City Literature Fest Day 3, organized by SGR Knowledge Foundation. I, Ms. Purva Bangle, will be the anchor for this session. Today, we have with us author Nandini Sen Gupta, who is a Pondicherry-based journalist and a writer. She already has several fiction and non-fiction titles to her credit. Her first published title was a non-fiction Babies from the Heart, which was published by Random House India. Her first two novels, The King Within and The Poison Heart, a part of historical fiction trilogy on the Gupta Empire, published by HarperCollins India, are already out, and the third book is due in the summer of 2021. Her first historical fiction title for young readers titled The Story of Kalidas, The Gem Among Poets, was published by Iser Good Earth Publications. Hit the stands last December, and her next book, a historical non-fiction title for young adult readers for Hashit India, will debut this November. She is currently researching medieval India for a narrative historical non-fiction book for Penguin India. With her, we have our moderator Swaima Ahmed, who is the co-founder of Footprints Event Private Limited. In due course of her professional journey, she has conducted more than 1,500 corporate workshops and soft skills. She also serves as trainer for Dell, ITC, Cello, Luxure, Junior Horlicks, National Stock Exchange, Whitehead Junior, Classmate, and Manipal University. She's also the founder and host for a talk show, The Forever Fears Show. She holds many awards and accolades under her belt, including winner of debate and elocution championships at national youth festivals, best student award for 2015-2016 at IIM Nagpur University, gold medalist in Masters of Arts in English. She also represents India at the South Asian Universities Youth Fest as an Indian delegate for literary events in 2016 and 2018. Making a significant contribution to the society, she also serves as the president of a Nagpur-based NGO, Footprints Foundation. And today, for the next 40 minutes, she'll be in conversation with Nandini Sen Gupta, ma'am, talking about the history, the role of animals in history. Now, I hand over this session over to you, ma'am. I welcome you both on the behalf of SGR family in Aurum City Literature Fest.
Thank you so much, Purva.
Most welcome.
Thanks a lot, Purva. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's a cheerful welcome I bring to each one of you to this session today. Let's talk about the role of animals in history. I'm so grateful to Aurum City Literary Festival for having us today. And I'm very sure the next 40 minutes will be truly insightful because we'll be walking you through some of the most intriguing things about animal history in India. Mark Twain had once said, "The land of dreams and romance, of fabulous wealth and fabulous poverty, of genie, giants and Aladdin lamps. The country of 100 nations and 100 tongues, 1,000 religions and 2 million gods. Cradle of human race, birthplace of human speech, mother of legend, grandmother of history and the great grandmother of traditions." These the glorious words best stood upon India for its incredible way of life. And in this session, ladies and gentlemen, let's understand as to why animals happen to be an integral part of Indian history. And today we have with us an author who is par excellence. Someone's authored a number of books that give us a sneak peek into not just Indian history, but gives us different perspective on history. And her latest book that we'll be seeing soon is The Blue Horse. And The Blue Horse talks about why is history not just about people and why animals. So we welcome you, Nandini ma'am. It's an absolute honor to be hosting you, and seeing your credentials absolutely make us swell with pride. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Swaima. It's an absolute pleasure sharing this platform with a young achiever like you. I'm so proud. And so happy to see young India doing so well. The Blue Horse is my new book. Here it is. The Blue Horse and Other Amazing Animals from Indian History. And this book is very close to my heart because it combines everything that I find interesting and worth fighting for, because I love animals and I love it. And in a sense, giving animals a voice through this book has been a hugely rewarding journey, because I have always wondered what animals must be making of this world of ours, you know, a world that is dominated by a species that is as selfish, often wantonly cruel, as human beings. So this is a very special book for me. And I'm so glad that Orange City Literature Festival has offered me the chance to talk about this book.
Thank you for that sneak peek, Nandini ma'am. Could you please tell us what really provoked you to look into an issue like this, you know, the concerns of animal, or how animals and human beings can coexist? So could you please tell us about the inception of the book?
You know, I have been researching ancient India for about 10 years. And while doing my research, I came across some really incredible animal stories. And the more I read, the more I felt that while the heroes of our past are lauded, remembered, revered to this day, some of the animals who shared center stage with them have been completely forgotten, you know, and that's a shame, really. So oh. If you look at, say, somebody like, you know, the first story in my book is about Emperor Akbar. Now, we all know about Akbar. And if I were to ask you, what do you think is the most interesting thing in Akbar's court? You will say Tansen, maybe, and his beautiful songs, or maybe Birbal and all those funny stories, right? But you'd be wrong, because the most interesting thing in Akbar's court were his pet cheetahs. You know, and there is so much of material available in history. Remember these stories that I talk of in this book. This book is fiction only to the extent that the animals tell their story. Otherwise, everything in this book is history. I did not make it up, you know. So these stories are there. And I thought it would be fun to look at these stories, to bring them out, to dig them out, and to present them for young readers so that they'll get a different perspective on history.
Absolutely. Thank you, Nandini ma'am. So, ladies and gentlemen, in fact, Nandini ma'am left no stone unturned in doing justice to the historical figures by talking about their own pets, including Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj and his pet dog Vagya. And Nandini ma'am talks copiously about this as well. So some of the episodes from the book. So ma'am, is it also your location right now, Pondicherry, that actually, you know, sets your creative juices flowing? So how does region affect, you know, a person's literary panache, according to you?
Thank you, Swayma. Interesting question, because I truly believe that if I wasn't in Pondicherry, much of my journey as a writer would have been stunted, because Pondicherry is a very serene place, and it is a place of Sri Aurobindo and the mother, and their beautiful grace envelops all of us. It is a place which is quiet, which is, you know, tiny little place tucked away at one eastern corner of India, very far away from big city hubbub, you know, all the glamour and glitz that goes with living in a big city. But it is also a place that gives you some perspective. It gives you the ability to take a break, to take a deep breath, to look at life itself and stop running for a while. If you're living, you know, we used to live in Delhi for many, many years. And unlike others who say Delhi is horrible, and you know, on Google and all that. We actually had a lot of fun living in Delhi as a young couple. But living in Delhi or Bombay or one of those big cities anywhere in the world, you know, London, New York, wherever, there is a pace to that life. And that pace has its own demand. When you live in a place like Pondicherry, those demands are less. Then you can sort of sit back and take a moment or two to look around yourself. And for me, that ability, the independence that gave was to find amazing stories to tell. I'm so glad you brought up Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj and his dog Vagya, because that is one of my favorite stories in the book. Also, because this is one dog, and again, a very, very, it's a subject very close to my heart, because I truly believe that I have two beautiful dogs, but I believe that we should adopt, not shop for dogs. And this is an indie dog. This is a, what we call a stray dog, whom Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj picked up and took him as his pet. And he grew into a shadow. He became his master's shadow, you know. And it is such a beautiful story of faithfulness, of sacrifice. That is just amazing, you know. And I had so much fun telling that story about how, you know, this little scrawny little puppy who was picked up becomes an amazing, he becomes a Vagya. It truly becomes a tiger, you know. So that's it was, I had a lot of fun writing that story.
Remarkable. So basically, ma'am, your answers, your energy, your enthusiasm speaks volumes of, you know, your passion for writing, especially on a subject like this that we're discussing right now. So ladies and gentlemen, we've seen how location, the serenity and tranquility of a place can incredibly impact a writer's ability to reach out to more people. So Nandini ma'am, do you think these turbulent and complex times of COVID-19 have been fruitful and prosperous for our flora and fauna? If yes, then please give a sneak peek into how COVID-19, these times, have given our animals an opportunity to flourish and thrive.
You know, animals are always typically treated very badly by human beings. I mean, I'm being disparaging about my own species here, but the truth is that very often we human beings tend to think that this world belongs to us and to no one else. You know, that everything in it, the oceans, the air, the trees, the flowers, the earth, the soil, everything is ours to do as we please with it. Unfortunately, that's not true. That is not true. And when you get rid of, or when you rapaciously use up one resource and it leads to the extinction of a species, that affects us. This is what we are realizing now. You know, COVID has allowed us to understand that you cannot survive in isolation. I will give you an example, and it is a very interesting example that I came across when I was researching for my new book. I realized that, you know, the lion is a very common iconographic totem that comes up in our history. Very, very common. I mean, from 5th century, the panels of Sarnath, for instance, in Madhya Pradesh, to more recently, you know, 19th century, 18th century, and 19th century Mughal and Pahari paintings, you find the lion cropping up again and again and again, alongside the elephant. Now the elephant is fairly common even today, right? I mean, you know, the elephant is not a rarity in India. You go to any temple, the temple will have a temple elephant. The elephant is very, very common. It's a common animal. So it's understandable that the elephant will be a very common motif in our cultural iconography. But why the lion? You only get to see the lion in the forest, right? The lion is not seen anywhere else in India. guess what? There's a reason for that. The reason is that even as early, I would say, a couple of years before the great uprising of 1857, the lion was abundantly available all over North and Central India. And there's this gentleman, you know, a British official. His name is James Forsyth. And he writes in 1851. So that's really recent, less than 200 years ago. Right? And he writes that as late as 1851, lions used to be spotted very, very frequently outside cities like Jabalpur and Allahabad. So you can imagine, I mean, today, if you go to Jabalpur, would you expect to see a lion? No. So the lion used to be a very common animal. We have made it extinct. We have made it a species that is only specific only to the Gir forest. This is what we have done. And so in a sense, these stories that I have written, you know, the blue horse is also my attempt to tell people that the corona pandemic is a wake-up call. We have to learn how to live with flora and fauna, not against it.
It's a very interesting perspective, Nandini ma'am. In fact, something I really liked about your book, The Blue Horse, is the fact that you've also given your attention and spotlight to other animals, you know, to minor species of animals. You know, what we generally see, even right now, if somebody goes for jungle safari, everybody's hell-bent to see a tiger, you know, or a cheetah. Or, you know, we don't really care about the other minor species of animals, and we're not interested in watching anything but the tiger or the cheetah, you know. So it's high time that we also understand the fact that a jungle safari or an exploration is also about the other animals that come together to form the biodiversity in a jungle. So could you please comment on this? How we as laymen, you know, we as explorers or travelers need to start developing the sense of sympathy and empathy towards all the species of the flora and fauna, not just the majestic or the regal ones.
Swaima, you know, again, I'm going to go back a little bit into history. If you look at some of the objects that have been dug out, and I'm not just talking about India here. If you look at objects that have come up in Roman ruins, in Egyptian ruins, and so on, Mesopotamian ruins and so on, you will find that very often animal motifs crop up in objects of everyday use. All right. So, for instance, I'll give you an example. There is this beautiful, absolutely stunningly beautiful votive vase, like a flower vase, which has this motif of elephants all round the bottom.
Okay.
Now, this flower vase, if you look at it, it can very well be a flower vase that you will go out today and buy from, say, a place like Dilli Haat. Right? Very beautiful. Except it is from Chandraketugarh. Chandraketugarh is a very famous archaeological dig in Bengal, and it dates back to the first century BCE, which means it's more than 2000 years old. So again, like I said, this is not a stray example. Even today, you know, you have jewelry designs, for instance, which have makara or fish motifs. Where I come from in Bengal, you have peacock pendants, you know, pendants in the form of peacocks. In Tamil Nadu, the makara or fish-shaped earrings are very common, even to this day. I mean, if you go and buy jewelry, you'll see those animal motifs cropping up. And just a couple of days ago on Twitter, I came across this amazing, absolutely amazing pair of rings, Anglo-Saxon rings, 9th century Anglo-Saxon rings. They belong to Ethelwulf, who was King Alfred's father, right? And they had these lion motifs on the rings. So why am I giving you these examples? This shows us the ancients had a way of incorporating animals, big and small, not just lions and elephants, but also parrots, peacocks, scorpions, snakes, Beetles were very, very common in Egypt, for instance. The scarab beetle was considered a royal symbol. So beetles, so insects, big animals, small animals were incorporated in daily life, in the designs, in the iconography of functional items, you know, toys, jewelry, furniture, you know, and so on. So it became, it was incorporated into our lives. The ancients knew how to do it. And again, I'm saying it is not just India I'm talking about. This is something that we find all over the world, right?
Today, absolutely.
We have lost it.
Mm.
So our furniture no longer has beautifully carved lion heads or elephant heads. Our jewelry no longer has that. As we cut ourselves out from our world, from the world around us, we cut ourselves out emotionally also, from the animals, from the birds, from the bees, from the flowers that populate that world. And that, I think, is a huge
outstanding example. Outstanding. In fact, sometimes we feel it's only the tribal, areas or the tribal people that have the responsibility to spearhead the process of continuing this legacy, not us, the so-called modern human beings, because as you mentioned, we've somehow disconnected ourselves from the profundity of animal history. Nandini ma'am, how can we incorporate the love of historical animals or the love of young guns these days, you know? So we know the process of storytelling and using Aesop's fables or Panchatantra and letting our kids know about the richness and the depth of animals in our history. But what, according to you, are some of the most impactful ways of teaching this to our kids these days and somehow reducing their screen times that happens to be the greatest cause of concern to them?
The reason why I wrote this book is to make children aware that animal stories, animals also need a voice. You see, because when you look at history, really, you will find that 9 out of 10 times, the point of view, the POV, is one-sided.
Absolutely.
Because if there are two people fighting a war, then the person who wins the war writes the story. One of my favorite historians, Sanjeev Sanyal, he quotes this amazing African saying that till the lion gets to write his side of the story of the hunt will always be written by the hunter. You see? So, you know, so
amazing.
POVs are always in history are determined by, they are one-sided. And I find that very often, for instance, they are male. The POVs are very male because the guys who are writing down, who are chronicling the history are men. So not only are the POVs skewed against women, imagine how much skewed they would be against animals. Because the people who are writing down those stories are all human beings, right? They really couldn't care less about animals. So there will be very perfunctory mentions about what the animal meant, what the animal's role was, and so on. So in this particular book, what I have tried to do is kind of flip the perspective, you know. You look at some of the greatest battles fought, like the Battle of Haldighati. All of us have read about the Battle of Haldighati. We have read about Rana Pratap, and so on. Here, it is Chetak who's talking about the Battle of Haldighati. So the perspective shifts from human to animal. It is the animal who's going through it. And similarly, you know, the Battle of Narainala. Instead of Rani Durgavati talking about the Battle of Narainala, it is her favorite elephant, Sarman, who talks about what happens in that battle. And looks at it from his perspective. So, you know, so I thought that was a very, very interesting way of telling young readers, any readers, actually, this book can be enjoyed not just by children, but also by adults, it is an interesting way of telling them that, you know, just because we are stupid, we don't understand what they are saying, doesn't mean that the animals don't have a point of view, you know.
Absolutely.
There was this amazing meme I came across on Twitter where there's a picture of a dog and there's a thought bubble and the dog is saying, I understand your commands. You don't understand a word of what I'm saying when I'm barking. Who is the stupid animal here? So just because we are not smart enough to understand what the animal is saying, does it mean that the animal doesn't have a voice and doesn't have a point of view? So this was my way of trying to tell children that, hey, you know what? Every sentient being has a point of view. Every sentient being has a consciousness. Don't disregard it. Respect it. Enjoy it. Because you have to live in this world with all of them. And that's what history teaches us, you know, really. Because that is something our ancients knew and respected.
Absolutely, Nandini ma'am. Revolutionary idea about the POVs and how animals need to take the center stage right now. So Nandini ma'am, we know how animal conservation is the need of the hour right now and how so many NGOs and governmental efforts have been consolidating this cause of animal saving animals and animal conservation. Now, I feel your attempt to really reach out to people and make them aware about the role of history, role of animals in history, is somehow a concrete effort towards this cause. And they say that awareness is the beginning of transformation. So this is, I think, an attempt to really make people more aware about their responsibilities and what they need to be doing right now, their action plan. Now, Nandini ma'am, could you please tell us how is this book, The Blue Horse, different from your previous work, The Poisoned Heart, The Story of Kalidas? How is this one different from the other books?
Swaima, you know, even in The Story of Kalidas, that was my last book for children. In The Story of Kalidas also, there is a very interesting role played by an animal. And one of the things that I have pointed out in that book is that Kalidas is different because he is a young boy. And we start the story when he is a young boy. He's about 11 or 12 years old at that point. He's a young boy who stops and gazes and appreciates the beauty around him. You know, the birds twittering on branches of trees, the butterflies going from flower to flower, the water in the mountain stream glittering in the morning light. You know, the beauty around him is something that that this little boy appreciates, young boy appreciates. And that is why he grows up to be one of the most iconic literary figures that we have ever known, that this country has ever known. This ability to empathize, see beauty in nature, in the world around us, I feel is intrinsic to Kalidas's poetry as well. If you read him, I haven't read him in the original. I have to admit this, I read translations, but even in translations, the empathy and the love that he has for the world around him shines through. And that is something that I've tried to, in a very, very simple way, try to explain in the story of Kalidas as well. When it comes to the Gupta Empire trilogy, there, the animals' references are a little bit different. You see, right from that point onwards, the kings were adopting animals as symbols of political or military power, military might. And this is, again, this is something that we see across the world and also in India. And in fact, there are these very interesting gold Gupta era coins, which show Kumara Gupta, the third Gupta emperor, slaying a lion. And the lion became a very, very, very strong, potent symbol for the Gupta emperors. Now, obviously, at that point, if I don't know if you've been to Ajanta and Ellora, if you go to Ellora, you'll find these huge, gigantic elephants. They perform the same kind of role of representing military might of some of the dynasties that supported and funded those sites. So what I'm trying to say is that the way the animals have integrated into our way of life is a very interesting process. I'll take just a few minutes to refer to the earliest example of animal art that we know in India. These are the cave arts in Bhimbetka in Madhya Pradesh. Now there, if you look at it, that's 30,000 years old, right? That was prehistoric man. And there you will find that there are scenes of hunts, human beings hunting animals for food. There are also scenes of animal attacks. So essentially what is being documented there is a largely antagonistic relationship between human and animal. But when you take a quantum jump and come to Chandraketugarh, which is 2000 years ago, there are these beautiful terracotta tablets of, there's one particular tablet which is my favorite, where they show a mother and a father looking on fondly and a child playing with a pet dog and a pet duck. Clearly by that time, the human evolution has ensured that animals were no longer just a functional necessity, not something to be killed for food, used for transport, or used in war alone. They were also friends, So human beings were making friends with animals. They were becoming friendly. So a dog is also a pet, not just something that you keep because you need to guard your house or you need to take it for hunts and so on. And a lot of the stories in the Blue Horse show this beautiful friendship that flowers between some very well-known kings, some not so well-known kings, between them and their pets, between them and their animal friends. And that was something that was very rewarding for me.
Wonderful. So, ma'am, this looks like a sneak peek into how incredible the Indian history is. It's flooding with examples wherein kings have given paramount importance to their pets. And thanks a lot for these examples, citing these examples to actually consolidate the idea of the role of animals in Indian history. We have a couple of questions from our audience as well. Somebody asks, ma'am, have you thought that the extinction of animals have greatly affected us as human beings, and what can we do right now to curb this issue?
Oh yes, of course. I mean, every time an animal goes extinct, we have to understand that we live in a circle of life, right? We are not standalone creatures. Every time an animal goes extinct, there is an impact on us, and therefore, as we fill our oceans with plastic and as we fill our soil with chemicals, we also need to think that at some point it will come back to bite us. So it is just, the whole natural universe is interconnected. And the more we learn to live in empathy with the world around us, the better it will be for us, for our survival.
Absolutely. So ma'am, we'll take one last question. Somebody asks, from where do you get this inspiration to write about point of views of animals in your books? Honestly, Nandini ma'am, that's a revolutionary idea, honestly, because being a student of literature myself, I am a voracious reader, and the kind of insights you've shared with us about your ideas on POVs of animals. It's revolutionary. So where do you really get this inspiration from? So what really sets you on fire?
I'll tell you. You know, my dog, Snoopy, my first dog, Snoopy was, I truly believe that that she was one of the most intelligent people it has been my pleasure to know. She used to sit with my mom and watch cricket, watch Sachin Tendulkar play and all that, and would bark at the right time. So I used to sometimes wonder that what is Snoopy really thinking about us? You know, here we are, you know, my mom would chatter on and I would also chatter on with Snoopy. Acha, khana khaya, acha, abhi bahar jana hai, acha, you want to do this? And Snoopy would, you know, nod, wag her tail and, you know, continue the conversation. So I felt that she clearly understood what we were telling her. And I used to wonder, it would be fun to get inside her head and find out what she did. So in this book, for instance, this book is dedicated, here you are. It is dedicated to Snoopy.
Wow. Nothing like it. Wow.
So Snoopy crossed the Rainbow Bridge 16 years ago. But wherever she is up in the sky, I think she's giving me a woof of approval.
Wow, that's lovely. So ladies and gentlemen, with this, we come to the end of this insightful, peppy and upbeat discussion with our author, Nandini Sengupta, ma'am. I take this opportunity to thank Nandini, ma'am, for being with us now for a short conversation on her latest book, The Blue Horse, and leaving us empowered with ideas on the role of animals in our history today. I absolutely enjoyed talking to you, ma'am. It was delightful. It was insightful. It was wonderful in true sense of the term. Thank you so much for being with us today. I thank everybody who joined in making this discussion a roaring success. Thank you so much. I wish you massive success. One last question, ma'am. Do you have any message to give to our young viewers today?
Sure. Love the animals and read The Blue Horse.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Nandini ma'am. Over to our host, Purva. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Each and every word spoken by you was indeed true and eye-opening to us. We failed as social animals to save the animals. We failed to know that we are a part of nature, not apart from nature. And it's really so disheartening. And yes, it was an honor to have you both. And on behalf of Orion City Literature Festival, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Also, I would like to thank my audience attending it. Hope you both have a great day ahead. It was nice meeting you both.
Thank you so much, Purva. Take care. Thank you. Thank you, Nandini ma'am.
Thank you, Swayma.
Good. 20 years of existence. 2 universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Thy Sony Group of Institutions. A vision beyond.